It wants to act up today. Let's see. You hear anything?
No. Can you hear me?
Oh, I hear you great now.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
It's a little static. I don't know.
It's a little staticky?
Just a little bit.
Okay. Anyone who's here, if you can let us know how the sound is, I would appreciate it. And then we'll continue on for that. We want to get these few little technical difficulties out the way that they're trying today, but I know why, but that's okay. We're going to do this anyway. Okay, I know someone's here because I saw him. Please say something. Give us a little comment. Let us know how does it sound. I know there's a delay with live too. You think it's going through in maybe a few minutes, so. Really, nobody's saying anything, but that's okay. But that is quite all right. We are going to get started. Let me see. Oh, great. Thank you. Somebody said you're good. Great. Thank you. I appreciate you. I'm a little further away from my phone, so I won't be able to read a lot of the comments. I'm not as close, so. But I want to say thank you for joining us this afternoon. My name is Pat, and I go by Mother Pat. The Lord gave me in 2001 a vision to help families in any way I can, and he gave me the acronym MOTHER. That's why if you look at my page, you see it says Mother Pat. MOTHER stands for my opportunity to help everyone resource. And when did we meet? About 2 months ago now?
That in May.
Okay. Oh, okay. Not long ago at all. Well, I met this wonderful young woman of God as I went to a ladies' conference sponsored by a friend of mine, Pastor Robin Stevens. And I sat there with my mouth open. And while I'm listening to her, Holy Spirit started speaking to me, telling me that he wanted me to get her to do some things because I saw so much in her that I've seen in a lot of young people. And long, long time ago, I was one of those young people, but because people, for various reasons, don't help them to grow their gifts, you know, because you can know how to do a lot, but the more you use it, the stronger it gets. And the Lord really impressed on me in the way I can to help her grow her gift, but her gift will also help younger people. And it'll help some of us old ones as well who need to hear from another perspective. And I'd like to introduce her to you. Her name is See, now get on here that I'm still getting ready to stumble. Aniya Demery.
Yes.
Who happens to be the daughter of Pastor, I don't know your dad's first name.
Ronald Demery.
Ronald Demery, mm-hmm. Who's the new pastor. He's not new now. He's been there a couple of years now.
Yeah.
But the pastor of Bible Way, the big Bible Way in downtown Washington, D.C. And I wanted to talk to her and let her share her heart, and maybe I'll ask some questions. And this is going to be the first of many such conversations with her. And I think with other young people as well, because what's really funny in the timing of the Lord, how he does things. We were texting each other because I'm getting her to speak at a back to school event next month. And while we were texting each other, she said something that made me say something. She was like, oh, you're preaching that. And I was like, and as soon as she said that, I'm like, okay, me and you are going to do a live about that very same subject. So this is different from what she's going to be speaking on the 23rd of the month. Look out for the flyers. You'll see that later. We're making a few changes on it. So I put it on social media, but then I pulled it. But I want you to hear from the voice of not the church to come, but the church now. I say it all the time. I know sometimes on social media, people might feel like I'm saying the same thing over again. I am, because as adults, we're just not getting it. And I say it all the time. There is no junior Holy Spirit. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as the Lord of your life and you've been endowed with the gift of Holy Spirit, it's no different than the Holy Spirit in an adult. The only difference is, as adults, how we treat them in that gifting. And let me get back to the texting back and forth with us. So right after we decided we were going to do this live, I think it's the same day, I saw the video of a young man I know he's African, but I don't know if it was in Africa, where he was doing worship. This young man did worship in a way I don't see most adults who stand up in front of churches do worship. His heart was so pure and so real before the Lord. And then right after that, Saturday, yeah, just two days ago, Saturday, I saw a boy receiving a prophetic word from Prophetess Val Moore Burgess. Now, in 2 days, it's had over 86,000 views, and she posted this Saturday night at 10 p.m. talking about the mantle and the gift that is on that child and how we as adults need to keep it safe and to grow it. And, you know, and so with that being said, I'm going to introduce her and let her say whatever she wants to say in the beginning. And then I have some questions here that I might ask as well. And like I said, this is going to be first of many, because as a body, we need some stuff that we're just not getting. And sometimes we can be so used to doing things a certain way as adults, we forget that we used to be younger. We forget that our way of doing things may be our way, but it's not the best way or the only way. So I give it over to you.
All right. First of all, hello, everyone. Thank you so much for tuning in. I'm just so grateful for this opportunity to be on live. My name is Aniya Demery. I am a youth director at Bible Way Church, located on 1100 New Jersey Avenue. I like to say preach or use my voice to minister to God's people. What can I say? As a 21-year-old who has been in ministry for a long time, I mean the majority of my life, but who has actually told God yes in the last year, it has been a challenge and it has been a struggle. as a young person, we're still dealing with growing. So as we are growing into people in ministry, there's a lot of challenges that come with that. And I believe as a millennial that we do need the older saints in order to grow. We are not trying to shun away the older people, the older saints, the adults. We are trying to just have our voice heard. Can you hear us? Do you hear the difference that we're trying to make? It's not that we necessarily want to break tradition, but we just believe that change should come. And so with that being said, I'm open for whatever questions that are coming next. I plan to be authentic and real. If most people know me, I do not sugarcoat anything. So what I say,
that's why I like you.
Exactly what I say. So this is live and I'm pretty sure people are watching. But I believe in being authentic and real at all times.
Good. Thank you. We appreciate it. I'm going to start off with a few questions and just say a few things. young adults bring a unique experience of faith and life to the church, reflecting their culture and how they express themselves. It's 2019, and it's time for us to intentionally help foster conversations, helping one another understand the broad range of experiences and influences that contribute to the wholeness of us all. We need you. You need us. You know, we need to. I looked for something today and I have to share this. I wrote this down. This was last year. And this is in the Catholic Church. The Pope asked about 300 youth that were with him from different faiths. And he asked them about helping the church. The first thing the youth said were, the church just won't listen. What do you feel about that?
I think I may feel a couple of ways about that. I feel like sometimes when it, as it pertains to change and anything regarding change is hard for anyone. And so in order for change to take place, somebody has to be uncomfortable. And with being uncomfortable, it's a challenge. And sometimes you have to be pulled and you have to be torn because change doesn't happen overnight. It's something that is continuously happening. So is it that I don't feel like the church hears us? I think that the church does hear young people. I think there is a pull on the necessary change that we would like to see. I think there's a pull on the older saints understanding that it's not that we just want to be buck wild. It's that we want to be radical for Christ. And when you put us in a box trying to be radical for Christ, it really does make us go crazy. And it makes it seem like it's rebellion when in all actuality is that let us be us.
Exactly.
I do believe that the church hears us. It's a matter of them listening and doing what we feel like should be done. But I also think that we as millennials have a lot to say, but we don't have a lot to do. So we make these requests to the older saints, but we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing as millennials, because if something makes us mad, we're quick to leave and go somewhere else. We have to have the backbone and the voice that changes what the older saints feel about us. We can't ask for something and not be doing something. That doesn't work. So I think it comes from both sides.
I love it. See, that's why I got you. From that one, I knew all of this was in her. And I was like, I'm just going to get her to talk. There was one quote from that same 300 youth, and it said, a lot of times as children in the church, they don't feel like it's a safe place or that they're welcomed and that they're loved because look different, dress different, do things different. It's the same as what you were just saying, but I just had to read that. And this is another question. What legacies do you think the church as a whole is missing and sharing with the youth?
Legacies. Wow, that's a great question. I believe that sometimes when the church is telling younger people what to do, they don't bring up the history and what it took for them to get to where they are. So there's a missing piece. What we need is a bridge, a conversation to understand why you act the way you act and why we choose to act the way that we act. So it's not that we don't want to carry the mantle. It's that we don't even understand the mantle that they want us to carry. So I believe that our conversation should be had between the older saints and the younger saints, because in the 2019 church, there is a gap. There has been a gap for a very long time. And at Bible Way Church, we're consistently looking for ways to just bridge the gap. Where is it that, you know, the generation of the 60s and up is missing the generation from the maybe the 30s and lower? Like, where is the gap? Where is it that we're not understanding each other? So I believe that if the younger people understood, just really understood where the older saints were coming from, and it's not always us not understanding, it's the older saints' approach to it as well. I believe that sometimes they can come off a little aggressive, a little hard, and so now we're hardened because it's like they're yelling at us, and we're just trying to understand what exactly is it that you want us to do, what exactly is it that we're missing, or what exactly is it that we don't understand. So I believe that it really takes a village to build the body of Christ. So it's not just the younger people or just the older people. It's all of us that are needed to carry the legacy forward.
Exactly. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And you said that because a lot of times, how can you carry a legacy that you don't know about? And especially, I'm a PK myself. My mom wasn't a pastor, but my mom was a preacher. My mom got saved when I was 6 months old. So that's all I know is church. But that generation, my generation is a little better, but they still don't talk the way they should. But my mom's generation, people like who are in their 70s and 80s, they talked about nothing. They talked about nothing, but they expected you to know. Just like you said, if you don't communicate, and communication isn't just talking. If I'm a teacher and I have a class and the class is not understanding what I'm saying, it's not the class's fault. It's me as the teacher. Mm-hmm. That means I have to change some of how I'm saying it. I have to do some changes so that they will understand. And that's what we have to get to the point. That we have to change some things. And that's why I'm doing this, because I want the older saints to realize we have to do some changing. It's not them. We do. We do. And I you know, it's easier for me to say that because I'm one of them. You know,
right.
I'm one of them. I mean, what? A month and a half, I'll be 58. Thank you, Jesus. Wow. I'll look it, but I'll be 58. Right. I'll be 58 years old. So I'm 2 years away from being 60.
Right.
And I understand and I see and I vividly remember the struggles I personally had. And the sad thing about it is not too much has changed. It's still the same struggles. The same struggles I had as a teen and a young person and a young adult. I'm looking at a lot of the churches, of course, it's not everywhere,
right?
But absolutely. I'm just saying the whole, you know, the body of Christ as a whole, there's still so many that have not made the change, but we want to see what it is we want to see, but we haven't changed. So we have to look at it. We're the ones that's holding you back. To be honest, I mean, it's we're the ones that's holding you back. Let's see. You know, and that gets me to something else I wrote down. The I meant to write where that scripture is, but the mission of the church is to equip the saints. Mm-hmm. It didn't say equip the old saints.
Right.
It didn't.
You're right, right.
It said equip the saints. If your child realizes at a very young age that they want to live their life for the Lord, they should not be the second thing in the church's mission. That should be a part of the mission. You know, you don't just have a children's, I'm going to say this. I know people who have children's churches, and the reason they have children's churches just so the adults can listen to the word, but they really, it's like, they're really not giving the kids some strategies to help with their life.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. They're telling them a lot of Bible stories, and we need to know the history. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying we don't. We need to know the history, but we need to know, we need to teach our children how to live today. We need our children to know that when they go into school, how to choose friends, which you're going to be talking about mm-hmm. next month. Mm-hmm. Our children need all of this. And we're as a body, we're too lax. Mm-hmm. We're too lax. But then we want what it is we say we want, but we're not doing anything to get there. So as a body, are we really equipping the saints? You don't have to answer that. We all know as a whole, we're not. As a whole, we're not. Let me see. What about, well, this goes right into the next thing I said. The last thing I just said, and I was going to ask you, do you think that the church is not spending the necessary time, resources, and development into spiritually fostering a relationship with God, not just teaching about who he is, but fostering a personal relationship with God and for the children?
I guess that's a very interesting question, a tricky question.
And loaded, I know.
Yeah, it is.
Question.
I just
personally... But we want to give people stuff to think about.
Yeah.
Even
yeah, it's definitely giving me something to think about. I think sometimes that church may push traditions before they push relationship. And I think sometimes that's where we lack in bridging the gap. I believe exactly. that this generation is kind of real and raw, and we can spot a fake from miles away.
Yes, you can. So that's why I love mm-hmm.
as the church is progressing, because there are progressive churches, but there's still awesome churches who remain in this traditional thing, and there's nothing wrong with tradition. My church is very traditional, but I feel sometimes that we are pushing the tradition more than we are pushing a real authentic relationship with Christ. We can do church.
Exactly.
We all can mimic church. We all can mimic the dance. Some people can't even mimic the tongue. But if you do not have the yes. real relationship, raw and authentic relationship with Christ, what good is it? There's no good. So I feel like sometimes it is, and when we say the church, it's the people who are in leadership, because there's a congregation, there's people in leadership, where we're not pushing an authentic relationship with Christ. We're just saying, come to church, come to church. Okay, after they come to church, now what do? They come to church.
Exactly, now what? Now,
what's next? Building an authentic, right. real, and relationship with Christ. So I do think sometimes the church may not be as advanced in that area of teaching people the true authentic relationship with Christ, and more so what we do inside of the church house.
Do you think do you think that that's a reason that a lot of young people I can't even say young people and older people, when you are into something and you're fulfilled in it, you're going to talk about it a lot. You're mm-hmm. going to tell your friends.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And so you think that's the reason that a lot of young people don't bring their friends to church? You know, they'll get up and say, why don't you invite your friends to church? But you're thinking for yourself, well, there are some things here that may not draw my friends to Jesus like I would like them to. I mean, I can be honest, because not where I am now, thank you, Jesus. But I've been a member at a church and I never invited anybody. You know, because I want them to see God at his best. And I don't say that thinking that there's a perfect church. That's not what mm-hmm. I'm saying.
Absolutely.
That's not what I'm saying at all. But I'm just saying, when, like I said, when you are authentic and you have a real relationship with the Lord, you want people to be able to get that, and you don't see that they can get it, so you don't invite them. You know, that's a sad place for the church, whether to be older like myself or younger like you. And I just threw that out there just to give us something else to think about. And as a church, I want to ask you this question. Do you think we are focused more on ourselves inside the church or the unchurched? I'm pulling you, girl. I'm pulling.
Pulling. That is a pull.
Because I know it's in you.
I believe, and this is just my experience. I've been in Bible in my entire life, but I also visit a lot of churches as well.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
I believe that we want to build relationships with the unchurched. And that word for me is really just, it does something to me because we can be in church all our lives and still not know Christ. So for, you know, for the church itself, for leaders in the church, I think we kind of focus honestly on both. We focus on the things that the people in the church need, but we also focus on why aren't the unchurched coming to church?
Right, they focus on it, but as a church, we need to do things because they ask the question, why aren't they coming? But they don't have the conversations like we're having. They don't have the dialogue to actually find out
why they don't come.
Yeah.
And I definitely, and with me being a millennial and with me, I don't just, my close circle is people who are spiritually inclined, who do go to church, but my gift doesn't stop in the church. My gift goes outside the church. And so I do sit down and I do ask people, how come you don't come to church? Or why is it that you don't like? And I know a lot of the reason is people in the church are hypocritical. They're judgmental. They don't know what to say to you. And then they ask questions that really put me in a place where let me think. They say things like, you know, why should I serve a God who kills people? So there's a bunch of different reasons why people don't necessarily come to church. It's not even come to church anymore. It's why they don't even believe in God. So
yeah,
I believe that the leaders of the church, they want to bring those who don't even believe in God into the church. It's a matter of how do we do it? Where is it that we can grow as a church? And I also believe that the leaders in the church, they do a lot care more about the people inside of the church, because almost like if you're in the church, this is my clique. This is who I relate to. This is who I can talk to. This is me right here. So I'm gonna just speak to this right here that's in my pew, but I'm not gonna go outside and talk to others. I'm not gonna go outside my Christianity, or I like to call it a disciple of Christ, and I'm not gonna talk to the Muslim, and I'm not gonna talk to Jehovah's Witness who doesn't believe what I believe. So I believe that there is a disconnect, I would like to say, a disconnect in how do we bring those who don't necessarily come to church? How do we get there?
Mm-hmm,
some comments on here. Tarita, I believe, she said, they are being prejudged. I have asked that question several times to others. As long as you have a relationship with God, not religion, that's what really matters. Yes. And they do give that reason that they're being prejudged before they walk. But I also believe that we have to understand that the church itself is not full of perfect people. It's full of hurt people. And as much as we would like to say, when you come to church, you shouldn't get hurt. Or when you come to church, this didn't happen, that shouldn't happen. Regardless of what we feel like it should not be, it is. Because there's broken people in a hospital. Mm-hmm. And that's what the church is. There's broken people here. And there's people here who have been going there for years who have not been healed. They're just coming to church and don't have that authentic relationship with Christ.
Exactly.
So once we step outside of why people don't come to church and ask them why they don't even believe in God, we can move to the point why people don't come to church. But I want to tap into your heart. Where's your heart? Not church. Where's your heart? Where's your mind? Why do you feel like that? What traumatic experience led you to feel like this? So often we talk about why people don't go to church, but what led them to be like this? What is the root of it? And I think sometimes we don't do our due justice as disciples of Christ. The first thing we want to do is jump to a conclusion without having the process and the conversation.
Exactly. Exactly. Or sometimes, and I can say this about the older generation, and because they didn't talk, they also sometimes they would see things, but they didn't know how to handle it or didn't know what to do, so they wouldn't say anything. I can't even talk about it. I can talk about me,
right?
My part of my life story, and I had some things happen in my childhood, and somebody that I'm very close to did not find out about it till a few years ago, and she was so hurt and disappointed in herself because she said, I knew something was going on in your house, but I didn't do anything. And she was about to cry. I said, don't make me cry. you know, but we have to get, even if we don't have the strength within ourselves to put ourselves in the middle of somebody else's thing, if you at least talk to that young person. And see, that was me. I didn't have anybody. And I know without a shadow of a doubt, that's why the family unit and youth is where the Lord has always kept me with my ministry. Mm-hmm. Everything I do is surrounded by that because I want to keep other young people from a whole lot of the mess I wound up having to be healed from, sitting right on the pew of the church. You know, sitting right on the pew with the church.
Yeah, I definitely.
My heart was right, but I was having, I had so many personal issues at home that led to different actions and stuff I did. But nobody saw that. They just saw you doing this and you shouldn't be doing that. And you know, they were looking at the outward and not looking at it. But God was looking at my heart.
And I believe that sometimes. I want to say church people, because I think that's what I want to use. Church people look at the outside when Christ people look at the heart.
Exactly.
And sometimes we were lacking in the spirit of discernment. And we as a body of Christ could help so many people if we took the time to spend time with God and for him to strengthen our discernment. Because even at 21, I'm praying, you know, God, I don't know everything, but strengthen my spirit of discernment. Why is this child, as a youth director, I'm very, very keen, and me and as well as my other youth director, I'm very keen in on our children. We can tell when something is wrong because we've prayed together that God would give us the spirit of discernment to understand what's going on and pull them to the side and ask them in the spirit of love. Everything that we do has to be done in love. Even if you correct somebody, it's to be done in love. And sometimes I feel like that element is missed in the church, that you can say what needs to be said, but in the spirit of love. My mother tells me, she'll tell me in a heartbeat, that skirt is too short, but she'll say it in love. She won't do anything while you going out here looking like anything. I mean, she does say that, but I know it's out of love. And when you know that when people are hurting, love is the thing that puts it back together. Not talking about somebody, not gossiping to somebody else, not trying to be God, but just love in itself. And I feel like we would grow and we would see some things if we just turned our spirit of discernment up in the body of Christ as a whole, period.
As a whole, period. You are so, so right. You are so, so right. As a church, are we on top of the constant change in the world culture?
I want to say that's a very interesting question, because I believe that there are some churches who are on the forefront with the change, with the upgrades of technology, with the upgrades of life in general, but I also believe there are some churches who have decided to stay traditional And I believe it honestly is to each his own. I think we're dealing with that because we don't want to bring necessarily the worldly things into the church. Because then the question asks, what is the difference between the world and the church? What is the difference between what we're doing in church and what they're doing in the world? So I believe that some churches may be progressive in the way that they represent Christ. And I think some churches just stay in the tradition because that's what they know and that's what they're comfortable with. But I feel like it's almost like to each its own. Which way do you want to go? Do you want to go to a church that's more progressive and in technology and the way that they represent Christ? Or do you want to stay in the more traditional church? It just really depends on your preference. But a church as a whole, I think it's like 50-50 because it swings both ways. Even just here alone, if you go in D.C. down the street, there's more so traditional churches than it is when you come to Maryland. There's a lot of progressive churches. So I just really believe that it's probably 50-50 right now as far as progressing and change and all of those things that have come with it.
Yeah, the only thing I would add to that is we just don't want to be like the word says, the traditions of man make the word of God of none effect. We don't want to just be so traditional that we don't allow the Spirit of God to be who he is in the Spirit of God. And he's forever moving. He is the river of living water. So he's moving. So you don't have to move everything. You don't have to, just take away everything you're doing and do everything different. No, we're not saying that at all.
Absolutely.
But what we are saying, it's just move as Holy Spirit leads. That's it. You know, we just want to move as Holy Spirit leads and leave the lines of communication open. I'm going to take a few minutes and tell, we have quite a few people on here today, and I want to ask you to do us a favor, if you would, share and comment. The more you share and comment, the way Facebook Live is set up, more people will see it. It won't show up the way they have the algorithms, however you say it. The way they have it, the more people share and comment, it goes to more people. And we need everybody to kind of hear this and just to keep it in mind as we all go to our various places of worship. You know, just to keep these lines of communication open so that we can all grow. I mean, growth. So we can all grow, so we can all change. You know, we're supposed to be lifelong learners. And as adults, just because we've been doing it 30 years this way,
it doesn't mean
that we have to continue. It was good. It did what it was supposed to do.
In that time.
For then. Yeah, it did what it was supposed to do then. But it's a different time. God never changes.
But the way you present him.
His attributes never changes. But the way he does things change. We don't drive the same cars we drove 40 years ago. Most of us don't wear the same clothes we wore 40 years ago. Or wear the same hairstyle. But we want to come to the household of faith and do everything the way our great grandma used to. You know, when times have changed and times are moving on, the Lord has given us so many avenues, so many ways to share the word. Like here, I mean, 20 years ago, there was no Facebook Live. Mm-hmm. You know, there's ways to get the word out, to help. That everybody who's watching, there is a young person, whether they are blood or not, there is a young person that you have a relationship with. Make sure that you, as the adult, let them know that you're there for them, that you want to help them grow in their relationship with the Lord. Live a holy life before them, first off, so that they will have somebody to look up to, you know, have somebody to look up to, and live a holy life before them. You know, I know she sees it being a youth leader. I started being a youth leader way back in the day around your same age at my church. And I have always, and it was even before I had my children, I've always had kids that flock to me and talk to me. And some of the stories that kids will share with you about what they're going on, what they see at home, and their moms and dads in church preaching or shouting, or the mother of the church, and it's ridiculous. It is. But then these same children, they see God through how they see us as adults. Mm-hmm. When you're a child, you look up to the adult. If the adult is mean, you're gonna grow up thinking that God is mean. If that adult around you never shows you any affection, never shows you any kindness, never shows you any love, you're going to grow up as a child thinking that God is that way. And we don't want to do that. We don't want to do that. The scripture in, I looked up the scripture, but I said, oh, I want to see what the Matthew 19:14, but I did the Passion Translation. I wanted to see what that is, because Passion is talking about the love of God. It says, Jesus overheard them and said, I want little children to come to me, so never interfere with them when they want to come to me. For heaven's realm is composed of beloved ones like these. Listen to this truth. No one will enter the kingdom realm of heaven unless he becomes like one of these. Not talking about childlike, it's just talking about your heart, a pure heart. And it's up to us adults to guard our children's hearts, not to be the one to break the hearts of the children that you're saying that you want to come to the Lord and you want to serve the Lord. So I wanted to add that. Let me see if I have anything else. No, I already said that. Let me see. Yeah, as adults, we need to learn how to have courageous conversations. And stop acting like an ostrich with your head in the sand when it comes to stuff. You have to confront it. Confront it in love. Confront it in caring. Make it a safe place. Make it a safe place. And that's normally where young people, they don't feel that they can come and talk to a lot of adults in the church because they know that they're going to be judged. But guess what? God doesn't do you like that. So why are you going to make someone else feel the way that God doesn't even do you? You know, so, and unless you have something else to say, I'm almost finished, but what I want us to do, because we are two generations here, I learned something that I shared about a year or so ago in my church, where the Lord had me do a teaching on, we repent for things that we do, but the Lord told me to repent for things my parents did, but they didn't realize they did it. And that I was still suffering from the effects, and it wasn't anything I'd done, but it was generational. So what I would like to do is for us to, after you say whatever it is you want to say, for you to say a prayer for your generation and, for your generation. And I'll say one for my generation. So we're going to represent the body, these two generations, so that we can, I'm about to get caught up. All right. Keep talking, Trisha. Okay. Woo. All right. Woo. I feel Holy Spirit. Yeah. He just reminded me because I forgot to write it down, but he's going to remind me of this to pray out and to ask forgiveness for these generational things.
Yes, yes, yes.
That we are still reaping.
Yes.
Yes, so some of these generational things that we are still reaping, because there's too much to do. There is too much to do. The world is crying out for us, for my generation and your generation, for us to take our rightful places. So that we can make Jesus famous, basically. You know, we can't, if we don't get ourselves together, that's why we're not seeing the miracle signs, the wonders that we should see. Mm. You know, we have to get ourselves together to see the miracle signs and wonders, and then help grow the kingdom of God. Absolutely. Help grow the kingdom of God. Go ahead, Anaya.
What I think, you know, the Lord has given me to say is that as millennials who are in the Christian faith and as disciples of Christ, it is our duty and our due diligence to bring those who are underneath us up. We are now an example for the generation that's underneath us. Not only are we example, not only are we leaders and are we teachers, we are students to the older saints. And as we try to figure out how we fit into this puzzle, this big puzzle, we need to open our ears to wisdom, close our mouths to nonsense, and be open to what God is doing in the spirit realm and in the world itself. I believe that God has poured out his spirit amongst the young people today. I've never even encountered as many spiritual encounters I've had with young people ever with, you know, anyone or the older saints. It's most times, a lot of times, I am a crier. I cry when I see that God has been pouring his spirit out on the young people. But may we not be arrogant as we grow in Christ. May we never get into a place where we are not humble and show humility as we are growing as young people in Christ. May we never get to a place where we feel like we don't even need the older generation, that we owe it all. May we never get to a place where we feel like that we have arrived and God is no longer needed. May we never get to that place. My advice to anybody who's young in ministry is to be obedient to the Spirit of God. It is not easy in no way, shape, or form to be in ministry at a young age. The other day, a prophetess was talking to me, and she said, I wish I could tell you that it gets easier, but it doesn't. She said, what I can tell you is that God gives you the strength to make it through whatever it is that you're going through. And that is my advice to anybody who's watching, anybody who's in ministry, not just young, but too older. It does not. When you're in ministry, it doesn't get better. God just gives you the strength and the peace to deal with what comes in ministry. I never would have imagined that at 21, I would be a youth director. I would be ministering God's word. I would be doing all these things in the body of Christ. I've never would imagine. And it was in the beginning that I told God yes, that I was going through so much. And I was questioning God, why me? And the prophet, she said something the other Friday, and she said, God says you've been asking why me, but God says, why not you? Why not you?
I was just going to say that.
And that stuck with me. I went through so much as, you know, in school being bullied, and I've gotten to a place at 21 where even if they're persecuting me for all the colors in my hair and my nose ring, all 8 earrings in my ear as I do ministry, I would never stop the ministry of God. Nothing that nobody says to me will stop me from being bold and courageous for the body of Christ and for the kingdom. So my advice to anybody who's in ministry who doesn't look how they think you should look, who doesn't talk how they think you should talk, who doesn't dress how they think you should dress, be boldly and confident in this very thing, that the Spirit of the living God has given you this ministry, this opportunity to share with people. And I created an Instagram that's called Nadia's Voice, and I will be launching that pretty soon. And my saying is, be great, be beautiful, and be you. So that's my encouragement for anybody watching. Just be you. And being you doesn't mean you don't get the opportunity to grow. No, you need to grow. Okay? Grow is important. As you get older, growing is so important. But understand that there's nobody else in this earth that's you. There's nobody like you. So be you. Don't be a copycat. Don't mimic anyone. Be authentically you. And as we pray, we ask that you all will pray with us, because this opportunity is just not an opportunity. It's not by coincidence. Everything, I believe, happens for a reason. In this moment, the people who are listening to this is for a reason. This might be small, but God is saying this is going to grow beyond what we even imagine. And I believe God. I don't care if it sounds crazy to me. I believe God that it may be small, but it's going to grow. Yes. And as we get into God's presence at this moment, I just want, even wherever you are, if you're in your car, your house, at the job place, wherever it is, that God just rests in your spirit, in your mind.
Yes.
That we build this bridge together. It's not going to just be two of us. It's going to take a multitude of us to build this bridge. It's not just going to be the small people who talk on Facebook and who do Facebook Lives and who share videos. It's going to take the entire church as we bridge this gap between the younger generation and the older generation. This is the time that God is calling us. This time is pivotal in how we move. And at the end of the year, I just believe God is going to do some miraculous things. But we are on one accord. And when we are in unity, their God will be in the midst.
So come on here, preacher.
Let us pray. I'm ready to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this moment, for this opportunity to talk, God, for this conversation that's needed in the body of Christ. God, we thank you for just being you, God, and being authentically you, God, and being real. We give you praise, God. We give you glory. There's nobody like you, God. We exalt your name today, God. We thank you that you are about to bridge the gap, God, that you are about to open our ears to what you are saying, God. We thank you for being in the midst. We thank you for standing in the gap as we get ourselves together, God. We thank you for any carnal thinking that is not like you, God. We bless your name, God. Help us as the younger generation to relate to the older generation. Help us not be so easily bruised, God, but to listen, God, as we mature and as we now carry the mantle, God. We ask that you would give us strength, God. We want to be in ministry, God, but we really don't understand the responsibility, God, that it means to be in ministry, God. So strengthen our mindset, God. Open our ears, God. Flow in us, flow through us, God. We ask that you would bless those who are amongst us, God, around us, who are surrounding us, God. Bless the young people, God, to think like you, God, to be more like you, God. We come against the enemy trying to separate the church, God, trying to separate the age group, God. We come against any demonic force, God, that is trying to come into the church right now, God. We bind the hands of Satan. We bind the hands of the enemy right now in the name of Jesus. Anything that is not like any of us, God, we ask that you will remove it, God. We thank you right now, God, for what you're going to do by the end of the year, God. We decree and declare, God, that this bridge, God, that is missing, God, that this gap will be full, God. We ask, God, that we will be on one accord, one unity, God, one mind, one mission, one vision, God. We give you so much praise. We give you so much glory, and we give you so much honor in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. I agree with her prayer. Hallelujah. Yes. And Father, I ask from the older generation that, Father, that you forgive us. That you forgive us. That you forgive us, Father. That you forgive us for overlooking yours. They're yours. There's no junior Holy Spirit. There's no junior Holy Spirit. Forgive us. Forgive us, Father. Forgive the ones older than me. Forgive us. Forgive us. I stand in the gap as your intercessor right now in the name, Lord Jesus. Glory. Oh, God. Ah. Jesus. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. God, we give you glory today. We give you the glory today for what you're doing.
Yes, God.
We thank you for bridging those gaps. We thank you for everyone who is doing their own part. I know of somebody else who has something a couple of times a year where she does this, but differently. She does like a little luncheon on Saturday. I can't think of her name right now. Lord, I thank you for her ministry that it's going to grow. And for Lord, you're just going to do pop-ups all over your people getting together, that we've decided enough is enough. Mm-hmm. Enough is enough. Mm-hmm. We're not going to let the enemy divide and conquer anymore.
Yes,
God. Right in the house of the Lord. He's not going to divide and conquer anymore. Mm-hmm. And then who's suffering but the children, but the young people? Because we can't let go of what was, of what used to be. Mm. And Father, I thank you. Mm. I declare and I decree this day as your woman of God. Hey, Yamasha, Shibada, Bashida, Ubagana, Bashida, Wusha. Woo! Glory to your name, Jesus. Glory. I give you glory. I give you honor. And now we're just going to walk in thanksgiving because we're going to look for you to do it. We're just going to look. We're just going to thank you. We've said the prayer. We're just going to look for your signs, miracles, and wonders because we are living under an open heaven. We really are. So we just got to get ourselves in line so that the blessings can come up and down, so the angels can just bring them from glory to earth. And we thank you. We thank you. We glory in you, Jesus. God, I thank you for my guests. God, keep doing what you're doing in her. Ah, Yamashe. Mm. I see greatness. From that one day I saw greatness, I knew that we were going to hook up. I didn't know how you were going to do it, but I knew you were going to do it. You're a great God. You're all-knowing God. You're all-sufficient God. And we thank you. We thank you that the church as a whole, our ladder will be greater.
Yes.
So that we can make you famous on this earth. We can make you famous, Jesus. We love you. We bless you. We glorify your most holy name. It's in Jesus' name. We say yes and amen, because we know that's what you say to us. You say, come before your throne boldly. Hallelujah. And we just stand on your word today. Hallelujah. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Glory to your name,
amen. Jesus.
Thank you, honey pie. Mm.
Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you. Thank God. Thank you.
Yeah. Whew. All right, guys. Thank you for joining us today. We will be doing some others. I'll be doing with her, and I have a couple other young people as well that I'm going to be doing these with. The Lord has a way of changing what you think you're going to do. Mm-hmm. In the ministry he's given you, or just add some other things. So, see, me and you get along, because I told you I'm a crier too. I just, everybody know me. I boo. You say, "Halle," you ain't even got the Luya out, and I'm crying. So, oh Lord, have mercy, Jesus. But thank you. I love you. But I was going to say, people, please share. Please share. Please, please share. It's not about her. It's not about me. It's not. It's really not. It's not about us making our name great. This is about the Lord and his glory being seen. Amen. Through the church like it's supposed to be. Amen. His glory being seen. And so people will want to come and get to know him, no matter which branch of Zion you're in. Amen. But getting to know him. I bless you and I thank you. Until next time. Be blessed of the Lord and nothing less. Love you.
See ya.
Bye-bye.